Hello and welcome to this webinar for teachers about the changes to Cambridge English Young Learners exams, which will come into effect in January 2018. I'm Sally Matson, one of the assessment services specialists who collaborate with Cambridge English. In this webinar, I will tell you briefly about the rationale behind the changes we've made. I'll then look in detail at the changes by paper and give you some ideas for classroom activities you might like to use or adapt to help prepare your learners for the new tasks we're introducing. We'll also take a look at the assessment criteria for speaking, which, as well as undergoing some revisions, have been made public. Nancy will then outline the support and preparation materials available on our website. And finally, I'll be joined by the Assessment Group Manager for Young Learners, Lynn Stevenson, for the question and answer session, which will end our webinar. First, let's look briefly at why we've decided to revise our exams for young learners. As part of Cambridge English's ongoing commitment to improving the quality of its tests, all our tests are regularly reviewed to ensure they remain relevant to learners and schools. YLE was last revised in 2007, so we wanted to ensure that it took into account the latest thinking in curriculum design, pedagogy, and assessment for young learners. We also conducted extensive surveys of those who used our tests: teachers like yourselves, parents, and exam centres. From these, we were able to identify where additional changes would be welcomed. A final driver for the revision was to position the tests more clearly within the context of our main suite exams, particularly Key, Preliminary, and First, to create a clear path for children as they progress in their language learning through school. Users of our tests have told us what they thought were the strengths of YLE, what it is that makes it so popular among their students. Based on that feedback, here are some of the things we are keeping the same. The colourful and fun activities that motivate primary school-aged learners and reflect sound teaching methodology. The fact that there is no pass or fail, every child receives a certificate that rewards their achievement. The importance of testing all four skills: reading, writing, listening, and speaking. The step-by-step progression through the levels, starters, movers, and flyers, which are designed to allow children to build on their skills as they move up. The wide range of support materials available, and the research underpinning the tests. So, what has changed? Firstly, it's important to note that there are very few changes to the overall structure and format of the tests themselves. We still have three levels: starters, movers, and flyers. And there are still three components or papers: listening, reading and writing, and speaking at each level. Timing remains the same for all of the components. We were essentially focusing on some very fine-tuning during the revision process. I'll now talk you through these changes. I'll do this paper by paper. So let's start with listening. The new Starters Listening Part 1 task is now the same task type as Movers and Flyers Part 1, but targeted, of course, at pre-A1 level. Here's an example of the new task. Instead of placing objects on a picture, children will now identify the people in the scene. You might remember that the current task focuses on the testing of prepositions, but this is also tested in Part 4 of Starters Listening. With the new task, then, we're removing this repetition of testing focus and also creating progression through all three levels, starters, movers, and flyers, by having the same task type present in all, but obviously graded appropriately for our candidates. This task requires the competencies listed on the slide here. I'll give you a moment to read them. If we focus on points 4 and 5 on the slide, it's clear that candidates must be familiar with the names they will encounter in both spoken and written forms. Let's look at those names. So these are the 20 names that starter students need to know, but the letters are mixed up. The capital letters obviously indicate the first letter of each name. I'll give you a minute to unscramble as many of the names as you can. Don't worry, you don't need to write these down. Okay. And so in a moment you'll see the unjumbled names. And here are the unjumbled names. How many did you get? This is an activity that you might like to use with your starter students in class. There are, of course, a number of ways in which this activity can be conducted. You could have your students do it orally or written, individually, in pairs or in groups, or as a competition. It's also a good idea to draw your students' attention to which are boys' and which are girls' names. To reinforce this in a fun way, you could ask your students to stand up and jump or step left for a girl and right for a boy, as you call out names at random. 4 names on this list are, of course, gender neutral: Alex, Kim, Pat, and Sam. One thing to note at this point, as an aside, is that the word list has been updated as part of the revision to include more words that are commonly used by children nowadays. Please make sure to use the new word lists available on our website with your classes. As part of that update, 5 new names have been added. Can you spot them? And feel free to type them into the chat box. So let's see if anyone spotted them. Yeah, we've got a couple of answers coming in now. Okay. Okay, so a variety of answers there. Okay, so now you can see that the names in green are in fact the new names. These names can now be found in the 2018 starters word list. So here's another activity that you could use or adapt to help prepare children for the new starters listening task. Remember, the key skills are understanding the language, hearing and reading the names, and drawing lines. The activity is Listen and Act. It's a TPR, Total Physical Response activity, which is one that combines listening and speaking skills with actions to enhance and reinforce learning. Let's look at how it could be done. First, each student will have a new name. These should be starters' names. Give each student a name label, badge, or name card with their new name on it. Ask the students to introduce themselves to the class by saying, for example, "Hello, my name is Tom." This will help all the children familiarise themselves with the names and give some additional practice for the speaking test. Ask the students to listen and do an action. Say some statements in the present continuous, Tom is talking on the phone. Remember to use the word list when coming up with statements. The child or children who are Tom should mime talking on the phone. You could ask the other students in the class to tell you what Tom is doing. In big classes, where there are multiple Toms, you could encourage children to race to be first to mime the action, to add an element of competition. Now let's move on to look at the changes to the listening paper at movers and flyers. First, we've dropped the drawing item from the last part, part 5, at both movers and flyers. Our research showed that this task caused anxiety among some candidates who were worried about their drawing skills. Feedback also suggested that the drawing task was not always entirely age appropriate. We've also replaced the current Part 3 at Movers with a task which is more similar to Flyers Part 3, again in an attempt to achieve a steadier progression through the levels, though of course only incorporating level-appropriate language at each one. Let's look at an example of the new Movers Part 3 task. In the current paper, candidates match days of the week and activities. The new task is still a matching task, but the range of focus and language is wider. Candidates are required to listen for words, names, and more detailed information in order to match people to activities. The detailed information is contained in a conversation between two speakers, but the answers are given by one speaker throughout the task. For Flyers Listening Part 3, as with the Movers task, the detailed information is contained in a conversation between two speakers, but the answers are given by either speaker throughout the task. And so, as you would expect, the challenge is higher at Flyers, both in terms of the language used and the cognitive load of the task itself. So that's it for listening. We now move on to the YLE reading and writing component. The starter's question paper has not changed to any great extent. We have made some very small changes to just two parts, parts 1 and 4. First, let's look at part 1, a sample of which you can see here. If you're already familiar with this, you will notice that starter's reading and writing part 1 remains broadly unchanged. There are still 5 questions, although only 3 appear on this slide. However, there is one difference. The task now includes both singular and plural nouns, which involve the use of this is a and these are in the questions. In the example question here, we have these are grapes and this is a house. In fact, this change provides, in some questions, a further clue to candidates. This change is intended to allow for more variety of language to be used in this part of the test, in a natural and appropriate way. In terms of preparing your students, you might wish to include greater focus on plural noun forms in your classroom teaching and in any vocabulary review activities. The second change to the starter's reading and writing paper refers to part 4. As you can see, again, it is very similar to the current task, but content will now be semi-factual. This text, for example, is all about horses. The move to a semi-factual task has been made to bring a content and language integrated learning, or CLIL, element to the task. One thing you might like to do in class is to help your learners prepare for the new part 4, and also to benefit their learning more broadly, is to try and incorporate similar factual texts in class when working on reading skills, and ideally ones that might help reinforce things students have learned in their other subjects. Moving on to Movers reading and writing, a number of changes have been made to this paper. The task order has been changed so that easier tasks, as identified in our research, appear at the beginning of the test. The number of questions has been reduced from 40 to 35. The biggest change, though, is that a new Part 6 will replace the current Part 2. Let's look at a sample of this task to see what's involved and how it's assessed, before thinking about activities you could do in class to help your students prepare for the new task. Here is the new task for Movers Reading and Writing Part 6. The writing task is structured through a 3-step progression. The challenge increases with each step as the amount of scaffolding or support decreases. Using a picture prompt, candidates first complete 2 sentences using 1 or more words. This refers to questions 1 and 2 on the slide. Next, For questions 3 and 4, candidates answer two questions about the picture. They could do this by writing a phrase or sentence. Lastly, for questions 5 and 6, candidates write two sentences about the picture. No word prompts are provided for this task, as candidates are expected to draw on their own vocabulary, as well as their ability to write simple, short messages in basic sentence form, starting with a capital letter and ending with a full stop. These sentences should be distinct from each other and from any sentences or phrases in previous questions within this task. Movers Part 6 has been developed to give candidates the opportunity and freedom to produce writing at a level appropriate to their ability. Not only does it aim to allow strong candidates to show off their 4 or 5 shield skills, but it also gives weaker candidates the chance to complete the task successfully by producing language at their level. Our focus in designing this new part was to provide a positive and motivating experience for all children by developing a task in which all candidates could succeed in terms of communicative achievement. A total of 10 marks are available for Movers Reading and Writing Part 6. Let's see how the marks are awarded. Candidates can score a maximum of 1 mark for each of questions 1 and 2. 1 mark is awarded for a response that provides an accurate representation of the picture. Candidates can score a maximum of 2 marks for each of questions 3 to 6. For each question, 1 mark is available for a response which is comprehensible, and 1 mark is available for a response which is an accurate representation of the picture. Also, for questions 5 and 6, the answer needs to be specific to the picture on the page. Any pre-learned or vague answers, like "this is a good picture," are not seen as representing the picture. Equally, if the vocabulary is totally inaccurate in describing the picture, no matter how accurate the grammar and/or the lexis is, then the picture is not represented and the maximum 2 marks will not be awarded. You'll notice here that there is no criterion for accuracy of grammar or spelling and no requirement to write complete sentences in questions 1 to 4, only in questions 5 and 6. Focus is on communicative achievement and clarity. Grammar needs to be sufficient to make meaning clear. Spelling needs to be accurate enough for the word to be recognisable. For questions 3 and 4, a short phrase is enough if the meaning is clear and appropriate. Apart from this being an important and level appropriate goal for assessing young learners' writing skills, the tasks and accompanying mark schemes have also been designed to support teachers in their teaching of extended and communicative-based writing. One thing to note is that sample tests are now available on our website, and so you'll be able to see the format and content of the revised Movers Reading and Writing test there. I'll now move on to look at a few activities aimed at promoting writing skills development in the classroom. I'm going to give you a few ideas, and I'd like you to think about which would work best in your context and why. The first activity is word salad. For this activity, prepare some cut-up words on different topics. There should be enough for 5 or 6 per student. Remember to use the new word lists for this. Include a mix of nouns, adjectives, and verbs. Students should write as many sentences as they can using their words. You could do this as a timed activity, with the winner being the student who wrote the most sentences. Sentences must, of course, be understandable to the rest of the class. The next activity is called My Family Holiday and focuses on both assessment criteria for Movers Part 6, comprehensibility, the focus of word salad, and relating sentences to a picture. For this activity, ask students to bring in a copy of a photo from a family holiday. Tell them it should be a photo of their family doing an activity, not just a portrait style photo. Then ask students to show their photo to their partner. In pairs, students then brainstorm vocabulary related to the photo. Students are likely to need support here, and they'll undoubtedly ask about vocabulary that isn't on the mover's word list, but this is fine. If students are keen to know a new word in English, just give it to them. Next, ask students to stick the photo on a piece of paper. Under the photo, they should write two or three sentences about the photo, using as much of the vocabulary they brainstormed as they can. This is a nice personalised activity. Another fun variation would be to get students to draw their own pictures. Since movers reading and writing asks candidates to write in third rather than first person, the next stage would be to ask students to swap photos or pictures with a partner to describe a classmate's family photo or picture. Lastly, jump the gap. Jump the gap is a fun game-like variation on a standard gap fill and a little like bingo. It can be played as a whole class or in small groups. Prepare a picture of a scene or take one from a sample paper on our website and write some gap sentences about the scene. As always, keep in mind movers level language and vocabulary. First of all, show the class the picture. Then ask them to write down five words related to the picture. You could do this in pairs to promote peer-to-peer support in class. Next, read your sentences, saying gap when you come across a gap. Any student who's written down a word which could appropriately fill the gap should stand up and jump. Ask the students to say the word to the class to check that it's a suitable word to complete the sentence by eliciting thumbs up or thumbs down from the rest of the class. Again, here we're reinforcing the need for comprehensibility and relevance to the picture in language production. Now, I'd like you to think about these three activities and vote on which one you think you'd definitely use in the classroom. You'll be able to vote on this now, so just select A, B, C, or D for your preference. And we'll just have a look at the preferences. I've got some coming up in the chat and also some coming up in the poll. So there's a race on at the moment. I think word salad is slightly winning, but luckily a lot of you have put all three, so that's encouraging as well. So now let's look at flyers reading and writing. Again, the task order has been changed to bring easier tasks to the beginning of the test. The current part two has been removed to make room for a new writing test, which is part seven. Let's look at a sample of this task to see what's involved and how it's assessed. Here is the new task for Flyers Reading and Writing Part 7. Candidates write a short story based on three picture prompts. These are sequenced on the page to form a narrative. No other prompts are provided for the task. Like Movers Part 6, this task has been developed and trialled extensively in various countries. It aims to give children the opportunity to produce extended written language through a task that is fun, level appropriate, and age appropriate. Candidates' responses to Flyers Reading and Writing Part 7 are marked on a scale from 1 to 5. A zero mark means that the question was not attempted or was totally incomprehensible. A response which scores five marks is one which describes a progression of events which are explicitly connected to each other, using connecting words or other connective devices such as pronouns for referencing people, animals or objects, and is based on all three pictures and requires minimal effort on the part of the reader to make sense of it. You can find full descriptors of the writing assessment criteria for Movers Part 6 and Flyers Part 7, as well as sample answers with commentaries in our handbook, which is available online. Let's now look at an activity you could use in your classroom to help your students develop their writing skills for this task. As you're listening, note down any questions or comments you have, and you can ask them afterwards. This is a collaborative or group writing activity. Students work in groups of six. Each group is given six pictures face down. For example, two sets of the three pictures you see on the slide. So effectively, you have two copies of each picture. Each student chooses a picture at random from the six. Students can look at the pictures they picked, but they mustn't show it to anyone else. Next, they should try to find the student in their group who has the same picture as them by describing their pictures to each other. This information gap activity gives students an incentive to practice their speaking and listening skills. Pairs with the same picture then sit together and write down words to describe or identify things in their picture. You could be more directive here and ask them to list three or four nouns, two or three verbs, and some character names, for example. Crucially, both students in each pair need to write down these words. Then regroup the students into six again and let them see the full story. That's all three pictures together, which form a set. Ask them to decide on the order of the pictures in the story. Check their answers by eliciting the story from stronger students if possible. It's important to note at this point, just as an aside, that ordering the pictures isn't something candidates will be required to do in the exam. The order will be given to them. It's still useful to give them the chance to do this when they're preparing for the test, as it focuses them on the presence of a progression of events, which is something they must develop in their writing. Now, regroup students into two groups of three, with each student having a different picture, so that the group of three effectively has the whole story. The groups of three then write sentences, isolated sentences, we're not yet ready to write a whole story, to describe what's happening in each picture. Next, review linking words, such as then, so, and so on, and other ways to connect sentences, such as pronouns to avoid repetition of names. Each time you do this activity, you could choose to focus on a different aspect of cohesion at this stage. The last stage is for the group of three to write the whole story. They can then read these to the larger group of six or to the whole class. Now that I've finished describing the activity, take a moment to write any questions you may have about it into the chat box. So we'll give you a couple of moments to write those questions. So pleased to see we've got some positive comments there. People say it's interesting and funny. Obviously, it depends on the number of students in your class, and you'll have to adapt that depending on how many children you have. And if any questions, we can deal with some of your questions at the end during the question and answer session as well. So naturally, preparation for the YLE test will involve practicing the actual test task and ensuring that students answer questions accurately and in simple short sentences or phrases. However, students who are exposed to a wide range of writing tasks, even those which aren't necessarily of the same genre as those in the tests, are likely to draw upon their experience and perform well in the test. The five tips on the screen now, in no particular order, will inform most learner writing activities. Getting your students to write regularly is key. This is something Cambridge English believes to be vital for learners' broad language development, not just for the tests. Collaborative, computer-mediated writing tasks have been found to motivate young learners and improve their writing skills, but candidates will need to be reminded that collaboration in the exam room is called cheating. Tasks related to students' interests and perhaps arising from real-world visual prompts, for example, magazine pictures, comics, internet images brought up on the interactive whiteboard, can provide content ideas which learners can shape into different types of writing. Now, on to speaking. In the current format, as you may know, starters candidates are frequently asked to respond non-verbally. While there are benefits to this, it reduces the opportunity for children to show us what they can do, even in the simplest of situations, such as saying their name. Also, giving a non-verbal response generally tests listening rather than speaking, and that's not the aim of this paper. So, we have made changes to the speaking paper, not only at starters, but also at movers and flyers, to give more opportunities for children to produce spoken language so that they can show their skills and shine, all the while providing support and scaffolding for all candidates. The first opportunity is at the beginning, where candidates are asked to say their name. This is also felt to be a more natural way to start the test. Starters candidates are just asked to give their name. Movers candidates are asked to give their name and age. And at flyers, candidates are asked to give their first and family names and age. At starters, we've also incorporated a new "Tell me about" question, which encourages children to extend their spoken responses. Let's take a look at this now. Here's an example of this new question. The speaking examiner asks the candidate to speak more fully, to an extent which is level appropriate, about one of the objects depicted in the scene in part two. For example, the examiner might say, "Tell me about this toy box." Expected responses are no more than "blue" or "it's blue." Support will be provided for any candidate who needs it through prompts such as, "What colour is it? Is it blue?" Here's an activity to help students prepare for the new starter speaking test, the "Tell me about" question. I'm going to demonstrate this activity. I am student A for the purpose of this demonstration. I'm going to describe a person, and I'd like you, student B, to guess who it is and point to the correct person in the picture. Ready? He's a man. He's on the boat. He's wearing a green t-shirt. Have you got it? He's sleeping. I'm sure you guessed it's this man. Now, my partner, student B, has a turn. Now, let's think about the changes to the speaking test at movers and flyers. There's just one change I'd like to tell you about. This relates to the story task, which is part two in the movers speaking test and part three in the flyers speaking test. Instead of just hearing the title of the story and the names of the main characters, these will be written on the story prompt itself. So you can see on the sample questions on the slide, "Fred loves food" is the title of the mover's story, and Fred is the main character. While in the flyer's example, "The Brave Teacher," there are two main characters, Nick and Anna, both of whom are clearly labelled on the prompt. This change has been made to reduce the anxiety some candidates reported feeling in trying to remember these details. As you might be aware, in the current tasks, these are just given orally by speaking examiners. In this final part of the webinar, let's look at the new speaking assessment criteria. Currently, candidates' speaking is assessed on a 3-point scale. The scale has been widened as part of the revision, and from 2018, candidates will be scored on a scale from 0 to 5. This will enable examiners to be more precise in their grading, and this also replicates scales at key, preliminary and first certificate. Candidate speaking will be assessed across three main criteria: vocabulary and grammar, pronunciation and interaction. Let's look first at vocabulary and grammar. As you can see, the criteria are similar for all three levels, but movers and flyers include some criteria which are not relevant to starters, simply because at starters level, candidates are not expected to speak at sentence level. So for example, here we can see straight away that grammar is not assessed at starters, and nor is cohesion, which is the way words and sentences are joined together using linking words and other cohesive devices. Now let's move on to the other criteria used to assess candidates' speaking: pronunciation and interaction. Pronunciation at starters is assessed at the level of individual sounds and word level stress. At movers and flyers, stress is assessed at word, phrase and sentence level, reflecting our expectation that children will be beginning to produce extended speech at the higher levels. Similarly, intonation is not relevant to starters level candidates, but it is at movers and flyers, again, where we're expecting candidates to produce more extended speech, and we want to be able to accurately assess and reward them for this. There are no differences across the three levels on the interaction criteria. Examiners look at a candidate's ability to understand and respond to them, the amount of help and support they need from the examiner to perform each task, and their fluency and promptness in responding. For example, is there a natural pause, or does the candidate need a lot of time to formulate their reply, causing a breakdown in smooth communication? By introducing useful phrases such as, "I'm sorry, I don't understand," "Let me think," or "Can you help me, please?" and encouraging students to use them regularly, you can help your students internalise them, and this will really help their interaction skills. Students can even make useful language posters for the classroom so that they can refer to them easily when they're doing speaking activities. These new scales will be made public, again in response to feedback from teachers that they would like greater transparency in order to be able to better prepare and instill confidence in their students. You can find the scales in the handbook, which, as we mentioned earlier, is available on our website. I'm now going to hand you back to Nancy for some information about support materials. And could you also type any questions you have about any of the new exam tasks or the activities we looked at today in the comments box for our question and answer session, which will close the webinar.
Thank you very much, Sally. That was a really interesting webinar. This is Nancy again. I'm just on audio, so you can't see me. While I'm talking, Sally and Lynn Stevenson are going to look through the questions that you've sent in. We've got quite a lot already. We've got plenty to answer. But if you have got a question that you haven't already typed in, just put it in the chat box now. And let me remind you that you will get an email after the webinar, probably towards the end of the week, which will contain a link to the recording. Quite a few of you have queried whether you will be able to see it again. So you will get an email with a link to the recording, so you'll be able to see the slides, listen to the webinar again in your own time if you want to. And you'll also get a certificate of attendance and a feedback form as well. Okay, so I'm now going to talk about some materials and resources from Cambridge English Language Assessment, which you and your learners might find useful. First of all, what you can see on the screen at the moment, a list of things that are currently available on the Cambridge English website. So we'll be providing new sample tests during the course of this year. The first one for each level is on the website already. Updated versions of the word lists and the handbook for teachers are also available on the website. So those three things, sample tests, word lists and handbook, the handbook for teachers are on the website already. by June this year, so that's next month, we are going to update the classroom posters, the activities that go with them, and the progress charts that show how well learners are progressing with these activities. The word list picture books will also be updated in June, and lesson plans will be available later in the year to help your learners for the new exams. So more things coming up. In August, the updated speaking test videos will be available. And these are useful both for training speaking examiners, but also for giving teachers and learners an example of what the revised speaking tests are like. And then quite a lot of the official preparation materials for young learners have already been updated. On the screen you can see the books that the official preparation materials that have been updated. So first of all we've got Kids Box, and this is a 6-level primary course, and it includes officially validated content to prepare students for the revised exams. Then we've also got Story Fun, which is in its second edition. This is based around the idea of using stories to input language. So for each level there are 10 stories, and each of them have got accompanying activities and a home fun booklet, and there are 6 levels in total, so that's lots and lots of stories to keep your learners happy. Then we've got Fun for Starters, Movers and Flyers. This is now in its 4th edition, and that's been updated as well. These books work really well alongside a general English course. And they've got they come with online activities for students, and there's also a fun vocabulary app for your learners to try. And finally, we've got the new practice tests for Starters, Movers and Flyers. One more thing to have a look at is the World of Fun website. On this you'll get all sorts of information, resources and teaching tips, and it's also the easiest place probably to find out more about the preparation materials that we've just mentioned. So have a look at the World of Fun as well. One more thing you might be interested in, this is for teachers rather than learners, is another webinar which is taking place on the 30th of May at 3 o'clock UK time. It's hosted by Cambridge University Press and will be presented by Karen Saxby, who is the author of Story Fun and the co-author of Fun for Starters, Movers and Flyers. And during this webinar she'll explore how storytelling and story making in the classroom not only help young learners to acquire elementary English in a fun, natural way, but it also helps them to complete more creative, productive tasks in Starters, Movers and Flyers. Okay, well that's it from me. We've got just over 10 minutes left now for Sally, who has been joined by Lynn Stevenson, to answer as many of your questions as possible. We've got lots of them to get through, so I shall hand back to them now. Thank you very much.
Hello again, and Lynn is now with me to answer some of your questions.
Hello, everyone. Hello. Very happy to be with you today.
So where should we start, Lynn?
Well, let's start first of all with a question that Farhat gave very early on in the webinar. They were asking who will mark the new writing tasks. We do have teams of specially trained markers. The way that it works, there's a training induction for all our markers, and they work in teams, so they have the support of their monitor and team leader at all times. We are very strict on monitoring of our markers, and even when the markers have been with us for a very long time, we still monitor a fair percentage of their work to ensure that all the markers are following the mark schemes. And of course there's a lot of reliability between the marks that each marker is giving, so there's no markers that are overly generous or overly mean with their marks.
We had a related question, didn't we, about whether the mark schemes will be available in time for and time for teachers to conduct mock tests with the students.
Yep, that's right. The mark schemes are in the handbook at the moment, which is on the website, and there are also some sample responses, and these were responses from our trialling, so they are responses that were written by real children with commentaries and the marks given for those. So we hope that will be a very useful aid for teachers as they're preparing their children for this part of the new tests.
Mm-hmm. I think it's always important to realise when you look at those as well that they're not necessarily model answers, they're not perfect answers, they're answers at different levels, aren't they?
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Okay, so good. Another question that a couple of people sent were concerned the timing. Now, the timings of both the listening and the read-write components for all three levels remain the same. We did trial extensively and kept a very close eye on the amount of time that the children that were taking part in these trials were taking on these, and we feel that the timing is right. We were perhaps looking to make it slightly longer for movers and flyers, as we have introduced extended writing in these, but in actual fact our trials showed that the children who were taking these tests didn't in fact need any more time. And the two tests do replace the current part twos, which movers and flyers candidates will not be doing in their read-write components.
Mm-hmm. I see that links a little bit here. We've got, Marina's just asked about learning difficulties, how we deal with students with learning difficulties, and we do have provision for that, don't we?
Yes, that's right. Any exam centres can apply for special requirements papers, just giving the case of their candidates, and we'll supply them with an appropriate test for these children to take. So we do have special requirements over a lot of learning difficulties, with children perhaps having support of somebody that they know in the room with them, if necessary, extra time and other things like that. All those details are on the website if you want to see further details on those.
And somebody's asking, can we upload more samples on the website? Obviously, we're just starting at the moment, but there will be more.
Yeah, there are at the moment a full set of papers for all three levels, and I believe in the next month or so there'll be a second set available. So plenty of materials to be prepared to start with for that. Okay. One other question going back to our review procedures was, what review procedures did you use to make these changes? Our revision procedure did start in 2014 and started with both a market survey, which Sally mentioned at the beginning of this. We spoke to teachers and to exam centre staff and to parents throughout the world for this. We also were in touch with educators and were getting expert advice on this. We did a literature review on textbooks, English textbooks for this age group, and used a combination of these to make sure that the revisions we were putting into place do reflect best practice at the moment.
I've noticed one question here from Masako, who said, should international students be familiar with English names? And do you want to
start? Right.
I would say yes, but there are reasons.
Yeah. I think, and I know that Nancy was replying to a few people who mentioned that during the webinar, the names that we use tend to be very short and straightforward, and we hope over different languages fairly easy to pronounce, so that they don't present children, whatever culture or whatever their first language is, with any great difficulty. I think that's why there may be the case that the names that we use tend to be fairly straightforward and simple names, and we don't have any names which are perhaps more intercultural, but it is for simplicity.
Also, it means that students can recognise that those words are names and they don't have to worry about the meaning of them. They know it's a name.
That's
and
right.
They know which names they're going to come across, so they're not going to be anxious about that being a different word they don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's true. So we've talked about timing. There was also a question about ages for the level. The Young Learners suite of tests are for 7 to 12 year olds. We know that in some places around the world, children much younger than 7 do take that. And we also know in other places, children much older than 12 do take them. So we don't, there is no rule that you must be within a certain age group for each of these tests. It is really basically a case of ensuring that any of your students who are going into these tests are comfortable, are going to be comfortable and able to do these tests according to the ability and the level of their English at that time. And a summary of the changes and the activities suggested. There will be, the webinar will be sent to you, I think, towards the end of this week. You'll get information there. And so all the activities will be on hand for you to review again. The, as far as the changes to the paper, to the Young Learners tests themselves are concerned, the specifications and the teacher's handbook and sample tests are available on the website. So there's an enormous amount of information there so that you can all be well prepared going into these new tests for the new year.
And we had a couple of questions about the factual content, didn't we? The semi-factual
stories,
and would they be relevant to national curriculums? Obviously, I think they'll be generally factual, so you can use anything that is relevant to your own students' interests and subjects. And you can have a look at the word lists for examples. You'll see from the vocabulary the kinds of words that they're going to come across.
Yes, so, yeah. That's right. So lots of information there. Let's see, a lot of questions. There is one, will there be two examiners for young learners as we have for KET and PET? There will still only be one examiner, speaking examiner for young learners, and we felt that was appropriate for the age group of these children. So it will be a one-to-one rather than a two-to interface for the speaking exams going forward.
I think we also found it was less intimidating for children to have just one
examiner.
That's
right, yes. It is.
Okay, still got time for one or two more, I think.
Okay, so done learning difficulties. Which level from the CFR meets each assessment? Starters is at a pre A1 level. Movers is targeted at pre A1 and A1 level, and flyers is targeted at A1 and A2 level.
So moving on, students can then move on to key if they after flyers.
That's true. And another question, do young learners align to the Cambridge English scale? We haven't aligned this specifically to the Cambridge English scale. The children will still get shields on their certificates and not Cambridge English scores, but on the back of the certificates they will show, as we do for IELTS, they will show where starters, movers and flyers fall on the Cambridge English scale alignment.
Okay.
Marks assigned for each part of the speaking test. There was a question for that. The three categories, the three assessment categories, the vocabulary and grammar, interaction and pronunciation, will be applied throughout the whole test. So there isn't a particular part of the speaking test where one of the, these criteria will be more important than any of the other two.
Thank you.
Okay.
So I think that's all we have time for now. So thank you very much for attending this webinar, and we hope you found it useful. You can see the website address on your screen for any more information.
Thank you.